At Lancaster Mennonite Historical Society, our vision is diverse communities connecting across boundaries by learning their own and others' stories of life, faith, cultures, and histories. Today's event is within the flow of our mission to feature the lived experiences and faith values of Lancaster Mennonites and interrelated communities. We value your investment in our mission. If you would like to support this storytelling and history mission with a contribution, follow the link on your screen, contribute through our website, or feel free to send a check. We thank you in advance for your partnership. Today you're in for a special treat as we hear from Nelson Okanya and Dr. Pamela Tieszen. Dr. Pam Tieszen serves as Superintendent of Lancaster Mennonite Schools, which has three campuses in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Previously, Pam served as Vice President of Advancement at Bethel College in North Newton, Kansas, and as Head of School at Freeman Academy in Freeman, South Dakota, her home community. Pam is on the Mennonite Schools Executive Council, serving Mennonite schools across the U.S. Pam graduated from Jamestown College, North Dakota, with a bachelor's degree in history and political science and physical education. She taught for 13 years in private and public schools. Pam earned her master's degree at the University of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and her doctorate from the University of St. Thomas, Minnesota, both in educational leadership. Pam attends Whitmer Heights Mennonite Church and has three adult children and one grandchild. Nelson Okanya was born in Migori, Kenya, and came to faith in his youth through the work of Mennonite mission workers in his community. He completed university and graduate school training in Kenya and the United States, focusing on counseling, pastoral care, theology, and missiology. He is currently completing a doctorate in intercultural studies at Fuller Theological Seminary. Nelson pastored a multicultural North American suburban Mennonite church for 5 years. He recently served as president of Eastern Mennonite Missions for more than 7 years. Nelson chairs the Global Mission Fellowship and is vice chair for the Missions Commission for Mennonite World Conference. Nelson currently works with the Center for Serving Leadership. He is passionately committed to a calling to missions, to partnership, and to serving leadership. Welcome, Nelson. Welcome, Pam. We look forward to hearing from you.
Good evening. Thank you for joining me on the journey of story and reflection tonight. I titled my stories, and the first one is called "And Then Life Changes." It was my first grade year, and I attended Rosefield Township School, a one-room country schoolhouse with one teacher, 16 students, grades 1 through 8. I had one classmate, Vicky. My older brother, Sean, and I, he was in the fifth grade, we would bike to school every day, 2 miles each way. It was a daily experience getting past the neighbor's dog, which always waited for us, and not in a nice way. The highlight of riding with Sean was when he let us switch bikes, and I got to ride his big bike, and he rode my smaller one. Country school presented a whole new world. It was like a family of 16 siblings, and functioned much that way. I remember the school bell. We got to ride a ring each morning. Riding the rope up and down was great fun. Vicky and I learned to read from the Dick and Jane series with Run, Spot, Run. If Vicky and I had questions while the teacher was working with other students, we asked the eighth grade girls for help. Otherwise, we spent a lot of time coloring and listening to the other students do their lessons at the front of the room. Our one-room country school did not have internal restrooms, and the outhouses were at the back of the playground. This was not a place that one lingered, or at least not as a first grader. I remember going out one afternoon and finding dead mice laid nicely on the seat. I returned to the teacher to share what I had found, and she came out to remove them. I learned it was a common prank by some of the boys, who later received a lecture for their little prank. I'm sure it was a disappointment for them that the first grader found the mice instead of the older girls, who might have had more of a reaction that they were looking for. Recess was great fun. With 16 students, we usually had enough for two teams to play whatever we wanted. And we all played, including us first graders. We spent the majority of our time playing softball together. I suppose it was in preparation for the softball game with our rival, the only other remaining one-room country schoolhouse in the area. I recall us winning soundly. Recess included other fun things like drowning out gophers. The boys brought 5-gallon buckets of water and poured them down the hole until the gophers surfaced. And then the real fun began, of trying to catch or put the gopher to a quick death. I'll spare you the quick death version. It's a little graphic. We also had a season of practicing for field day, and this is when my high jumping interest began. I learned from the 8th grade boys how to straddle roll the bar. The best recess was making grass forts in the ditch by the plum bushes. When the neighboring farmer cut the grass, we scooped it up and created a maze in the plum bushes. Ironically, I remember more about recess than I do about the lessons with Dick and Jane and the math flashcards. By the end of my first grade year, the school district decided to close our one-room schoolhouse, and we would be bused to school in town. I spent the summer mourning the loss and anticipating second grade. Life was going to change.
Good evening. Like Dr. Pam said, I'm glad to be here also this evening. What a special opportunity to share with you all a few stories from my life. Let me begin by reading a quote that I've liked so much. It's a quote that comes from a book called The Embedded Faith by Carlton Johnston, who was a youth minister in Australia. And this quote goes like this. Our biography, our sense of identity, is formed through telling our stories, which are embedded in the story of the communities in which we participate. In other words, our story, our stories that have been told to us and the ones that we have learned to tell. So they are selective depending on what you want to say. So I want to begin by telling you a story that comes from my mother. I was too young to know the details of this story. Early childhood and an escape from a tribal conflict. I was born in Migori County, Kenya, currently called, at a place called Ore Village. Ore Village was situated, or is situated, at the border between the two tribes, my Luo tribe and the Kuria tribe. Now, these two neighbors had a tendency to get in conflict, normally due to cattle rustling, because I think one community had a belief that the cows and the cattle belonged to them because they were given to them by God. And so when the other tribe had them, they had a right to go and take them. So you can tell why there was regular conflicts there. And so 9 months after I was born, my mother tells me, a conflict flared. And so my Luo tribe had received some intelligence that the neighboring tribe was going to raid the Luo tribe the next day. So men in the village got ready and women in the village got ready to take off. So my mother took me and strapped my 9-month-old baby on her back and started taking the few things that they had. My dad at that time was in Nairobi, as most men in post-independence Africa went to the cities to look for a job. So he was not home. So my mom took whatever she had that she could take and ran across the stream, which had no bridge. But she did that for 8 hours with a baby, me, 9 months old, strapped to her back. And she was able to take whatever she could take and left the household materials that she could not manage to carry. So getting to the other side where most of their tribal people were, in the evening, the warriors from the other tribe descended on their homestead and then looted whatever was left and torched the whole home to the ground. And that begins my life journey. And so after about 5 months of staying with relatives, they decided to relocate further away from the border to the current location where my parents live, in a place called Mukuro in Migori County. My dad, meanwhile, was stuck in Nairobi. He could not come back. He had not received a job. And so 14 months later, my dad finally made it to the village to behold his son. That was me.
Grandma and Grandpa Miller, life lessons. Visiting Grandpa and Grandma Miller was a mixture of fun and work. My grandma was very no-nonsense, so there was generally work to be done. My grandma was a quilter and a gardener. She had a large truck patch, a very large vegetable garden, and she had another regular garden by the house. This meant there was always produce to be cleaned and prepared for canning. She would pick the smallest cucumbers to make pickles, and it was the job of my younger brother and I to scrub and clean. There would be wash tubs of them. I remember long hours at the picnic table washing very small cucumbers that had a lot of spines on them. Grandma would come along and check to see if the spines were appropriately scrubbed off and return any that weren't done properly to the original tub to wash. Go through the process again. This part of visiting grandma was not so much fun. My grandmother was also a quilter. Her color schemes weren't exactly what I'd call fashionable, but she was passionate, and I treasure the graduation quilt made by her. I was very young, and I'm sure it was a way to keep a small grandchild busy. But from a very young age, grandma taught me to sew. She would take a scrap piece of cloth, make what she called a handkerchief, and then she taught me to embroider around the edges and create a simple design in the middle. I remember sitting in her sewing room while she was at the sewing machine and learning the finer details of embroidery. She also taught me to crochet a small chain, but I never saw the use for crocheting. There was an old piano in the front porch, and I remember Grandma playing hymns and singing out of tune to the out-of-tune piano. I was raised in a church where quality singing was a high priority. Grandma's playing and singing, as I remember it, didn't exactly match community standards. Today, I'm comforted by the thought of her playing old familiar hymns, and she is what comes to mind when those hymns are played in church today. My grandfather was also an incredibly creative craftsman, but for him, it was about making furniture. He repaired antique pieces for people in the community, and he refinished an old treadle sewing machine for when I was about 12. I enjoyed afternoons in his workshop, the smell of fresh cut wood, and watching him take the soaked caning strips that created the seat of a chair. Grandma and Grandpa loved the Mennonite game. It seemed every meal at their house was a discussion about distant relatives. I tuned it out. I found no use for discussion when I didn't know any of the players. It was a very poor choice on my part, because today I am the keeper of all the old photos and I'm having to do research to figure out who everyone is. Summer evenings at Grandma and Grandpa's were spent outside in the lawn chairs under the tree, facing west, watching the sunset. This was another time to be shelling peas or cleaning beans. There would always be discussion about the clouds building in the west and if it was going to rain. Grandma and Grandpa weren't overt in teaching us how to work or about their passions for craft and the precision with which they sewed or designed a piece of furniture. But we absorbed the hymns and the importance of work and craft by spending quality time with them.
Spiritual formation and learning the art of border crossing. I do not remember a lot of my early childhood, but I have anecdotal stories that I remember. As I left you in the last story, my story then continues. So Dad joins the village, goes back to Nairobi, and finally meets some Mennonite missionaries who had been kicked out of Somalia at that time, David and Grace Schenck. And while he was looking for a job, he did not have much luck. He tried several times without much luck. And then the Mennonite missionaries joined with some local Africans, including my dad, and they started a small Mennonite fellowship. A long story short, my dad became homeless while looking for a job, but then he was invited by the Schenks to stay with them a while he was trying to get his feet on the ground. His cousin, with whom he stayed, gave him bus fare and said, "You go back home because there's no job here for you." So Dad did not give up. He kept looking. And then with this Mennonite fellowship and then being invited, which basically the invitation itself was a countercultural and subversive action. This is an African village boy being invited to the home of Americans, and he had not even been in a modern house to begin with. So you can imagine the cross-cultural experiences. At least he was there for two weeks, it says. Dad remembers one time in Luo, when they say, go wash your hands, and at least in Africa, people say, go wash. And so there's some language issue going on there. So I think they told my dad, go wash your hand, before dinner. And so Dad heard, go take a shower. So the whole family is sitting, waiting, and this guy from the village was taking a shower. Just one of those little stories. So the Schenks had a huge impact in my family life, and they became Mennonites before I was born. So there's this story. They used to come sometimes pick us. Finally, Dad got a job. It's a long story, which I'll not go into right now. But through prayer and Bible study attendance, all that, Dad got a job and brought his son home to the village, I mean, to a slum of Nairobi called Mathare, the second largest slum in Nairobi, to stay in little one cubicle with his wife and son. And of course, they started having other children. And so, when I was seven, an incident had happened in our small village, I mean our small slum area. This boy had taken a rock and threw it at me. And so I took that rock. I wasn't a pacifist then. I didn't know anything. I was seven anyway. So I took that rock and tried to run after him. But while I did that, I did not recognize the fact that they lived on the other side of the road, which was a much better houses with glass windows. Ours was wooden window. So while he looked at me through the glass, I had no idea that there was something between us. So I threw that rock at him. Lo and behold, it broke the window. And my dad was convinced this is what he was worried about, this boy growing up in the slum of Nairobi. And therefore, an arrangement was made for me to go back to the village and be raised by my grandmother and the rest of my cousins. I will pick up from there.
Piano contest. I started piano in the second grade. I begged to start, and I remember my mom calling different teachers to get me on someone's schedule. I couldn't wait. In the beginning, I spent a lot of time practicing all the drills and the simple songs. Piano playing came easy, but it wasn't long before practicing wore thin. There were songs and lessons I enjoyed more than others over the years, and by eighth grade, I was becoming accomplished enough that I could play easy hymns. My teacher didn't host student recitals, but we had an annual piano contest in Parkston in the spring we had to compete in. A piece was chosen months in advance, and I would practice the piece for weeks because it had to be memorized. My teacher was good at her craft and kind. She also knew how to pick pieces that fit my character and knew what the judge required at that level. In my eighth grade year, I took a complicated piece. I don't recall the name of it, but it was fast and staccato, and I liked it. I felt prepared. It was my turn on the schedule, and I approached the piano, set the bench, tried to get comfortable despite the nerves, and eyed the judge, waiting for the nod that said I could start. I took a deep breath, and I was off. But the worst possible happened. I was only a short way into the piece, and both hands went off course. This was the kind of piece you could not adjust midstream. Or at least, I'd not learned that skill yet. It also wasn't just one wrong note. So while my hands are playing all the wrong notes, I was trying to decide how to get myself out of this situation. It probably didn't take as long as it felt like it did in my head to make the decision, but I finally stopped and asked the judge if I could start over. She kindly obliged my request. I started again. The second time through was successful, but I remember caring very little about the timing of the details of the piece. I only wanted to finish. I neglected to mention that in my previous years of competition, I'd scored ones on all my pieces. So the older I got, the greater the pressure to continue to score a one. This was pressure only brought on by myself. When I finished the second run through, I was more than certain that this was the end of my perfect streak. but the judge took pity on me and I got a 1-. I vividly remember the ride home. I told my mother that I was done with piano. I was pursuing sports anyway, and I would not need piano. She didn't fight me on it, as I recall, probably since practicing had become an ever-increasing battle. Or maybe she understood my anguish and embarrassment that day. Or maybe she knew her daughter was not going to be destined to be a musician. Per my demand, piano was dropped, and I have hardly touched one since. I pursued sports. I did not miss piano, and there were no regrets until my second son was born. No one tells you when you quit piano in the 8th grade that someday you will have a talented vocal musician as a son, and the piano skills would have come in handy. As his mother, I wished often that I could accompany him on his solos or preparation for musical theater. While I have regrets for not continuing, I also learned the value of starting over.
Learning the border crossing continues, and a thrill in the village of wrestling with a crocodile. So while growing up in the village, there's so much. Actually, the journey begins from Nairobi to the village. An occasion had occurred. One of the villagers had gotten sick in Nairobi and had unfortunately passed away. And it is the custom of the Luos that such a person needs to be buried in their ancestral land. So what happened is that the villagers gathered together, raised money, and got a van, minivan, and transported the body back for burial. That was my ride to the village. I was seven. I had no idea, nobody prepared me for what I was running into. The Luo funeral rites. After 10 hours in this minivan, we arrived in the village in the morning to uncontrollable wailing, funeral digests, people with masks on, big mask on, and I was scared like crazy. I had no idea what this was all about. And so they quickly had my aunt Jennifer come and pick me up. So she picked me up and we walked across to the village where my grandmother and the rest of the family were. And I remember when I looked at the houses, I was shocked because what I saw was a bunch of skin stretched all around the place. Of course, there were grass thatched roofs, but I thought it was skin. So I asked my aunt, how come all the houses have skin on them? And she just didn't understand what I meant. I got to the village and I started to get used to what it means to be in the village. In the village, my cousins, all, we slept on grandmother's house. Nice round big house, about all 40 of us or so, on mats and on cow hides. So that's how we slept. My grandmother was a Catholic, Roman Catholic, committed Roman Catholic. So she practiced prayers at night, in the evening, before kids slept. And she would come with her rosary and a cross. And of course, my wife Carmen knows this a lot because of the exposure to the Catholic tradition while you are serving in Central America. And she would be praying that all of us, and she'd be sprinkling cold water on us. That's called holy water. And so she would be sprinkling that water, and I could not wait for that cold, nice water to land on my face. First, it was cold and felt good. Second, it was holy. Now, the village can be a scary place. There are all kinds of superstitions, all kinds of talks about witches and talks about, you know, people giving you bad eye and all that kind of stuff, which is a very different world from where I was in Nairobi. So I had to learn what it means. And this prayer and this holy water became very important to me because I knew there was something that was protecting me from all these evil things in the village. And that was my grandmother's prayers. And so from there, the thrill. The boys, we went to shepherd. We took our cattle out every day, particularly on weekends, and we went far away into places to get to have the cattle get green pasture, and then bring them back closer to home to the next river for watering them, and also the boys would be swimming as well. One day, we had this practice down. You know, we knew what to do. And then we came to the river to have the cows and the goats and the sheep drink. But there was some grass that was starting to grow around the river. And so with that, we thought we would let the cows eat a little bit more. While they were doing that, we heard some commotion, some noise around the area. And when we rushed there, we heard this distressed cry of a goat. And when we got there, this crocodile, this place was known for crocodile sightings. At around 10 to 11 o'clock, when you went there, you would see this big reptile stretched out with the basically mouth wide open for unsuspecting bugs that were coming in. So long story short, the crocodile had striked this goat, and the boys decided that we were not going to let this go. So we got rocks and big branches, and we fought for a while. And lo and behold, the crocodile gave up. But we were able to get our lifeless goat back for meat. The crocodile did not eat it.
Aspirations. The decision to end piano was not only about my panicked event at the competition, but my deepening interest in athletics. From the time I was in the second grade, I was fascinated with the Olympics. In 1972, I was 8 years old and in the second grade, and found the 72 Munich Games riveting. Names I remember watching were Mark Spitz in swimming, Dave Waddle in the 800 meters, Frank Shorter in the marathon, and Olga Corbett in gymnastics. From that time on, I was determined to find a way to the Olympics. I loved sports and spent a lot of my time outdoors running, jumping, and playing basketball on the gravel drive in front of my dad's shop. We had a row of evergreens planted along the length of our driveway that was about 100 yards long, and it was the perfect run and jump course for me. I played any sports my parents would let me go out for in junior high. And in 1976, with the passing of Title IX, organized girls' sports were starting as I entered the sixth grade. In high school, I ran cross country, played basketball in the fall, volleyball in the winter, track in the spring. My events were the 400, high jump, long jump, and many different relays. Church softball was a summer league and played for fun. Also in high school, I subscribed to a sports magazine that advertised for athletes to join the Olympic team handball team, a European sport. It was a sport I knew nothing about, but they were looking for Olympic athletes for the 1980 Games. I applied and was invited to Colorado Springs Olympic Training Center for a tryout. I made the junior national team, and in the fall of my sophomore year, went to the Junior World Championships in Pristina, Kosovo. I spent many weekends preparing in Colorado Springs at the Olympic Training Center with other professional athletes from other sports. Every summer thereafter, I spent time at the Olympic Training Center either playing in sports festivals across the U.S. or on the junior national team. My senior year, the Junior World Championships were in Montreal, Canada, and our training took place at West Point Military Academy prior to going to Montreal. The U.S. ended up boycotting the 1980 games, but I was on track for the 84 games in Los Angeles. According to the Team Handball Federation, if your country is hosting the games, you have an automatic berth to participate in the games. Tryouts for the National Olympic Team, Team Handball, were in December of 1983 in Lake Placid, New York, the other Olympic Training Center. I was invited to the senior national team tryout, and on December 6, 1983, I was on my way to the airport in a fog so thick you couldn't see but a few yards. We were nearing the airport and had taken an alternative route, thinking it would be faster because the fog had delayed us. Within a mile of the airport, there was a train track we were unaware of, and there were no crossing lights. It was dark, foggy, and we braked for only a short distance before meeting with the train. I consider us fortunate. Our Datsun 210 was no match for the train, but thankfully, we hit the wheels of a car. The Olympic tryout was derailed, and all the athletes attending the tryout that December went on to the games the following summer in Los Angeles. I was grateful for surviving, but I missed the Olympic goal.
The spiritual life deepens. It was in fourth grade when I started to learn English. And soon after, my dad, knowing that I had learned some words in English, decided to buy me a book. That book is called My Book of Bible Stories. It had pictures and also references to scripture. And so he helped me learn the books of the Bible in English. And so I would look up the pictures and then look at the reference and read the story in my Luo Bible, which I knew. And so I learned to love the stories of the Old Testament. Now, this story will come back later. But I learned to read the stories of the Old Testament. I got into that. The characters that really caught my heart was Samuel, the baby Samuel, the boy Samuel, listening to the voice of God in the temple, and David. Those became characters that I really gravitated towards. I wanted to know their heart for God. There was something so deep in their soul, in their heart, that I longed for. And so that set me on the journey of spiritual search. And then my parents practiced these interesting things in the evening. We sung from our hymnal, which was called the Tenzi Zarohoni, which is the hymns of faith, translated by missionaries. And we got to learn this very well. And also, my mom is a wonderful singer. So she would be singing, I would be listening to these voices, and they just really set me on a place that my heart deeply sought. There were evening prayers whenever my mom, my dad got home, we prayed. Every time, it doesn't matter what you're doing, you have to get up, we have to pray. And when you're leaving, we pray. And that continues today. And so when we go home, prepare, boys and everybody that's going to the Okanya family, that's just the tradition, it continues. Let me put that into survival of a snake bite. When I was in 11th grade, I went to the village from high school, which was a boys boarding high school, which we stayed there for 4 years, but at least three times a year, we had time to go back to the village for school vacation, time off. And so I had gone to visit my grandmother, And my cousin and I decided to go on a walk at night. I had nice sneakers, but I gave them to him and I took his sandals. And luckily that night, we decided to look for a flashlight because the village is dark. The only thing that gives you light is the stars and moon. And so as we walked, I felt a knock on my right toe. And I wondered what that was because so timely. So I turned my light on, flashlight, only to see a little guy running away from me. It was a black mamba, this poisonous snake. And so, because I grabbed something and we were able to deal with that right away. And then my cousin, I was a Boy Scout. And so we had learned so many things about first aid, what to do, and all that. So we tied my leg up, and we went back to the village. But there was no hospital. And so some people came up with all kinds of crazy ideas. So, for example, somebody said, give him raw eggs. If he'll drink, he'll throw up, and that will take care of it. Well, they brought some raw eggs, and I completely emptied the substance. Nothing happened. So they decided, oh, somebody came up with another idea. If you find an old record, one of those record that they use in that player, and you grind it, you'll have magnesium, and you put it on the wound, and that will somehow zap the poison out of the body and all that. So they did all kinds of crazy stuff. But in the end, they decided to just let me go to bed. And around midnight, my leg was swollen, my head, my tongue, I couldn't spit, it was like somebody who just came from a dentist. It was just, I couldn't spit, I couldn't feel anything. It was a miraculous healing. By God's grace, I'm still here. Somebody in the village heard about that in the morning, came, gave me some herbs, prayed for me, and I'm here.
Wow, what a gift from each of you. Thank you. We're looking forward to some more story gems after we'll take a break in a moment. 2020 has been a challenge for all of us, but I, for one, am actually grateful for the requirement and the opportunity to be flexible in how we reach people and share our history and storytelling impact. Recently, our Mennonite Information Center, the 1719 Her House and Museum, and our Collections and Research Center have reopened to the public. Many of our family history resources are available online all the time, and I invite you to consider becoming a member to gain full access to those resources and to receive our quarterly publication called Pennsylvania Mennonite Heritage, among other benefits. Thank you for the support that many of you have provided in the past. We value your ongoing partnership and look forward to new individuals and households joining us in our mission. We'll now take a 10-minute intermission and be back with round two. It's a great time to make a gift, to get up and stretch, and we'll see you again soon. Welcome back. Are you ready for more stories? I am. And here we go.
The winter to remember. Winters in South Dakota can be severe or mild. One rough winter, I read the Laura Ingalls Wilder book titled The Long Winter to my kids. It takes on a whole new context when the wind is whistling, rattling windows, and the visibility is near zero and temperatures below freezing. It was 2001. We were milking more than 250 cows and caring for a lot of livestock. It was one of those winters where the storms kept coming. It was serious. First, I miss a really great blizzard that lasts 3 days. When the wind blows so hard, you can't see but a few feet because everything stops. However, doing chores outside during storms I don't miss. It could be a bit unnerving to go from the milk barn to the yard, about 300 yards, from the dairy barn to feed calves and other livestock, because the visibility could be so bad. Your eyes want to freeze shut and the snow freezes over the scarf. We had snowstorms that came weekly on Monday mornings. The timing was remarkable. And these storms were atypical in that the winds blew from a different direction and left more snow than normal on the roof of our large dairy barn. After one of the snows, it rained and left a heavy layer of ice and then more snow. There were places where the snow on the roof was more than 2 feet deep. This was one of those years where there was so much snow that the kids took their sleds and could start at the top of the barn roof and continued to sled to the ground because the snowdrift reached the edge of the roof. Remember, this is South Dakota and there aren't hills to sled on. So my kids still talk about the winter that they got to sled off the barn because that's as good as it gets. A storm would last 3 days and then it would take another day or two until the township snowplow could open the roads for a school bus or a milk truck. There wasn't much school that winter. Even if there wasn't much wind, it didn't take a lot for the snow to drift in and close the roads again. The breaks between storms were short and we could hardly get in and out. If the roads were open, we made a quick run to town for groceries and home before the roads blew shut again. It was all we could do to get chores done. The snow and wind slowed everything down, and there was more bedding and feeding required for livestock. Inside the barn, you could hear the weight of the snow load. The roof creaked and groaned. You could see the bend in the rafters, and soon there were cracks. Other large barns in the area had fallen in. We attempted to shovel off the roof, but this was a daunting task. Given the winds, we're replacing the snow as quickly as we tried to move it. Pushing it off didn't work because there was just too much. And when trying to throw snow off the milk barn, I couldn't throw it far enough to clear the edge of the roof. The layer of ice remained under much of the snow, so one slipped and fell trying to move the snow. The situation was becoming desperate until a couple of farmers from our church arrived with snow blowers to blow the snow off the roof. The barn rafters were reinforced and all ended well. Winters in South Dakota can be beautiful and challenging, but take note when the winds blow from a different direction. Grateful for the men from our church and the winter to remember.
So the Lord healed me, I believe. A lot of people in the village said that. There was no any other way to explain what happened. I remember around midnight when I was in so much pain, I woke my cousin Joshua up to pray with me. And we prayed. But short after he fell asleep, I woke him up a second time. The third time I did that, I was reminded of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. And I had a deep sense of connection to that experience. And by God's grace, I was made whole. First cross-cultural witness that set my direction, it was after high school that one of the missionaries, Carl Hansen was his name, with Eastern Mennonite Missions, discovered that there was an opportunity to do cross-cultural training and discipleship and witness. And that was about a six-week program at a place called Garissa, which is northeastern part of Kenya. Very, very dangerous region, bandits and all. And so all the words that we knew from the radio and all that is no one wants to go to Garissa. So when this opportunity came, and I told my dad, expecting my dad to say, no, you can't. I'd forgotten, I guess, that this guy always prayed for me, that I was God's call, that I was called and chosen by God somehow to be on God's mission. And that every time he prayed, the prayer was, I give him to you for your service. So what was I thinking? I went and told Dad, you know, this is the opportunity. What do you think? He said, well, if the Lord has called you, what can I say? Well, I ran out of options to resist, so I told Carl, yes, I will go. And so with a group of four other young adults, we boarded a bus to go to northeastern part of Kenya. Now, again, nobody had prepared me for what I was to experience soon. After a few, after about 30 minutes from Nairobi, we started to go into the wilderness all of a sudden. And the bus stopped and other buses came, and then there was an entourage of buses. And then we were joined by two military vehicles with submachine guns pointing to the forests. I had never seen anything like that in my life. And so that we knew then the danger has started, because the bandits would stop the buses, then they would steal everything, sometimes occasionally kill people. And so this was our security to the region. But then we got to a place where the buses would not go beyond. There were United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, UNHCR, trucks that were taking corn to the famine areas of that region, because it was very dry. And so they told us, if you guys want to go there, this is your ride. We have corn bags of corn out there. You can go crawl under that, and we'll put a tarp over you, and we can take you. So we did. And we got to that place, and we did our training. And then after 3 weeks of training, we were sent further inland. And while we were there, again, opportunities and cross-cultural experiences that I never had. We got into this hut when somebody was crawled up on the ground dying of TB. My friend and I walked in, and we asked him to pray for him in the name of Jesus. And he asked us, what is that? Never heard of that. But pray for me nevertheless. So we prayed for him in the name of Jesus. And that experience began something deep inside my soul. On that trip also, by God's grace, we were saved from a wounded lion.
Teaching, the Lost Boys of Sudan. I taught psychology and sociology for 5 years at Lincoln High School, a large public high school in Sioux Falls School District. Much like playing handball, this teaching experience expanded my world. Sioux Falls has an active Lutheran Social Services refugee resettlement program and a new American center that offers refugees additional support. When I taught in Sioux Falls, there was something like 68 different languages being spoken in the school district, in large part due to the resettlement of refugees. Lincoln High School, for a long time, served wealthy suburban families. But over the years, the district high school lines were redrawn, and Lincoln now served a very economically diverse set of students. I taught in Sioux Falls in the early to mid 2000s. And I had students from Serbia, Kosovo, Russia, Sudan, and more. It was well after the South Sudan conflict began. The Lost Boys of Sudan were a group of very young, orphaned children who walked a long distance without adults to a refugee camp. And their survival stories are one of a kind. Then they waited in the camps for quite a few years before being resettled, and many of them came to the US, places like Sioux Falls, Rochester, Minnesota, Texas, and other locations. Most of their last names started with A, and their birthdays were listed as January 1 because they didn't arrive in the camps with any documents. They were in my senior homeroom and made up a good portion of my 25 students. Some of them were probably 20 or 21 years old by that time. Most had jobs in addition to attending school in order to support themselves. Usually several of them shared an apartment, and they were assigned community mentors or families. They attended a local church or established a church with Sudanese who had arrived before them. In addition to homeroom, many of the lost boys took my sociology class. Because I had large classes, one of the tactics I used to learn about my students was to ask a question at the start of the period. One of my quick questions was, what was your favorite recess game? This left the boys from Sudan in a difficult position because they either didn't attend school in elementary or they didn't have recess games that fit the question. One student responded with how they stole each other's cattle. They would be out grazing cattle as part of their responsibilities, but if one boy took a nap, another boy would take his cattle as a prank. There were stories about monkeys and slingshots as well. We all learned cultural lessons about games. As a sociology class, we shared ethnic histories, foods, cultural events, and backgrounds. Sociology was a class that offered the space to break down barriers and unknowns for students and for me. During homeroom period, the student body had fundraisers and would come around with envelopes to collect donations from each classroom. Remember, this was a socioeconomically diverse school. It was always the Sudanese boys who pulled a dollar out of their pocket and contributed for the fundraiser and likely had no idea what it was for. My world was transformed by the lost boys of Sudan. I observed their resilience, making a new life, learning language and American culture, learning to live and drive in cold and snowy South Dakota. They were going to school, working, sending money back to Sudan if they found relatives. The questions they asked were about the bigger picture of life. It was a reminder that first world problems really are not very important. It was a chance to build a global community and understanding, and I was learning more than the students.
Our 2 weeks were finished in this village, and we made our way back to the place where we were to stay a few days before returning to Nairobi. When we got to a bus stop on our bicycles, we were shocked to see a man standing, well-dressed, in a bag in his under his arm. And we wondered who that might be in the same village where we had prayed for this man that was dying of TB. We went, and lo, it was him. God had healed him. And he was off to look for a job. Instant healing, that happened. I can't explain it. That's just what he experienced. So God had healed this guy. And my heart was set on God's mission to heal, to restore, to make whole. There are other stories on that trip that I will not tell tonight, but I do want to share a story that's related to this calling. And I've entitled this, A New Identity at the U.S. Consulate in Nairobi. So my church, Nairobi Mennonite Church, participated in the program of Eastern Merit Missions, then called YES, which was Youth Evangelism Service. And so rotating, they invited young adults to come to the States. And I was a youth leader at that time at our church, and I was selected to come to the US. So the process is that you go to the embassy, you submit your application, they look at you and they ask questions and they decide whether to give you 3 months visa or not. They call it 3 months tourist visa. So I went, I'd filled out my application and I submitted it, and the officer looked at me and she asked me a very odd question, which in my opinion was unrelated to anything I had written on my paper. She said, "What is the last book in the Old Testament? Remember the Old Testament stories in the village?" Yes, I knew the Old Testament. I had memorized most of the stories. And so without, you know, taking any beat, I just said, "Malachi." And she said, "I am not going to give you 3 months tourist visa. I am giving you 5 years missionary visa to the United States." And that began a journey. And so I was called a missionary to the United States, first by a U.S. Embassy officer. And that began a journey that has shaped my life for the last 24 years. So at this point, I've lived 24 years in Kenya and Tanzania, at least 1 year in service in Tanzania, and 24 years in the United States. And by God's grace, I've had opportunity to serve in church ministry, also including leading the very organization that sent missionaries, touched my life, and made it possible. My life is possible because of wonderful missionaries, and I owe them deep, deep gratitude. And so, by God's grace, I'm grateful that you came, because the world needs this gospel message more than before.
My final story, moving to Lancaster County. I've been asked often, "How do you like living in Lancaster?" Less than 4 years ago, I made the move from Newton, Kansas to take the position of superintendent of Lancaster Mennonite Schools. When I interviewed for the position, I flew into Baltimore and drove to Lancaster. And I remember thinking that all the trees and the inability to see any real distance was going to be an issue if I was moving to the east. But as I entered into Pennsylvania, there were more open fields, and then Lancaster County offered numerous farms and silos that made geography feel a bit more like home. First, I want to share a couple of painful adjustments. The traffic and roads have been most disconcerting. I arrived late in December, the darkest time of the year, and I think it rained every day in January. With roads not running straight, north, south, east, and west, my sense of direction was completely askew, and since I couldn't see the sun, I was lost. Certainly, there must be some underlying thought process to the road system here. It took nearly a year for me to finally give up believing. There must be a way to efficiently go from point A to point B. Nothing would bother me more than to drive a longer distance on a highway around to get to a destination when my mental map construct believed it would make much more sense to take a direct route. I tried it. That was not the solution. I've been told numerous times that the roads were originally old cow paths. But it seems to me someone would have devised a more coherent and efficient road system by this time. I can only say that without GPS, I'm not sure I would have survived. I still have moments of panic if my phone is running low on battery and will I be able to get home. The adjustments at Lancaster Mennonite School have been too many to tell in a 4-minute story. But I will say, when I first arrived, I wanted to and tried to understand the local Mennonite church context. After about a year, again, it became clear that I would never grasp the depth of the boundaries because only someone who grew up with it will understand. This was and has been painful. I am deeply grieved by the boundaries. God crosses boundaries all the time and has a way of shedding light and building new constructs that bring us all to the table. Watch how the winds blow. The Lancaster roads, churches, and school have caused me to develop new understandings of systems, structures, leadership styles, but not without painfully deconstructing my own mental maps, and this continues to be an ongoing process. Finally, the positives of Lancaster County. I completely understand why there are places named Garden Spot and Paradise. After growing up in a state that typically received less than 20 inches of rain a year, our garden produce was nothing like what you could grow here. Produce is big and bountiful and tastes amazing. And thank goodness I didn't grow up here, because I don't know how many tubs of little cucumbers my grandmother would have had. The trees I mentioned on my arrival to the East Coast are a mixed bag. I love them. The hardwoods and the fall color and the variety are beautiful. But I can't see the storms rolling in or a flashing traffic light at a country intersection 5 miles away. Winter is great because the leaves are off the trees and I can see a little bit farther. But as the leaves unfold in the spring, I get claustrophobia again. Lancaster has expanded my connections, deepened my faith, completely rerouted mental constructs. I'm a proponent of lifelong learning. I've made the choices, taken the risks, and have grown on the journey, and then quickly mourned the loss of stability and quiet. There is no question in my mind that God leads on the journey and introduces you to new people and places for the time and phase of life. Thanks for joining me on the journey.
My final story is a reflection on the life of my sister, Grace. I've entitled it Living Gently in a Violent World. But before I finish, let me give gratitude to my wife, Carmen Hurst Okanya, Barack, our son, and Isaac, as well as my in-laws, Vernon and Luann Hurst. Thank you for coming and joining us this evening, and for all of you. I finish with a story that has shaped me, even when I did not know it was shaping me. My sister, Grace, was born in 1985, when I was 13 years old. As a teenager, I was excited because there were other siblings that were there also. But I was excited to see a new baby sister. But as my sister grew, it became very clear, very quickly to us, that something was not quite right. Grace was epileptic. I watched helplessly as the seizures shook violently her small, delicate body, and there was nothing we could do. As I watched my sister, I began a journey of prayer. I did many prayers, fasting, seeking God, and asking for healing for my sister. That journey went on and on and on. Grace grew in body, but remained an innocent baby. She never uttered a word. But I always wondered what Grace was thinking. I always wondered what Grace was feeling. Occasionally, I think I figured out that there was something she knew that we did not know. When somebody made a joke, Grace would laugh knowingly, and I would wonder, how did she understand that? But I knew there was something about her that I did not quite get. But her life shaped me spiritually. I sought the Lord. I prayed for healing for her. But my concept of healing maybe was not the same as what God desired and did with her. 2018, my dear sister passed. But not before I returned home, because as I came to the U.S., it became much more difficult to connect with Grace. But Grace and I shared some very deep connection. And when I went home, people always said, Grace seemed to just know you. Because when you say something, Grace listens. And so 2018, when I went to the village, I thought I'd been away too long and she would not recognize me. But when I went and held her hand, she gave me a big smile and I knew she knows me. Grace lived gently. She showed me gentleness. She said no word, but I knew deep inside of her there was something so deep that I could learn. And so as I finish here, my sister went to be with the Lord. But I remember every time I thought about theology, I always wonder, what would Grace be thinking? How would she feel about what we're talking about now? So although she is gone, those questions continue to linger in my heart. When I look at people with any kind of disability, and I know that's a difficult topic, but we can learn so much if we only open our hearts to be taught. Remember, the scripture invites us to listen to the little children, and maybe those who are grown-ups, but are some places that have no capacity to do the things that we're able to do. Grace lived a gentle life, and I seek that God will help me to continue to learn to live gently in a violent world. Thank you all for listening.
Once again, thank you, Pam, and thank you, Nelson, for sharing parts of your journey with us. It's almost breathtaking how the Spirit weaves together our stories in ways that are both poignant and often just plain fun. Thanks to you for joining us today. As we conclude, I pray for myself, for you, and for our world. Joy on the journey, self-awareness, compassion and perseverance, and above all, attention to doing justice as we follow Christ. May it be so. Amen.